made the Lord his house, the man, the servant, the shepherd, the teacher, the leader, the feeder of this local body as he turned. Come on, help me thank God for him. Now, you can do what you did for me, you ought to be doing double and triple for him. Brethren, by the mercies of God, that ye present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. And be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that ye may prove what is good and acceptable and perfect will of God. I want to talk about when you know better, you do better. I promise you I can't finish all of this. When you know better, you do better. That's turned early in my ministry, second year of my preaching. Pastor told me I was on preach, and he told me he wasn't going to be there. Said he wanted me to preach, and somewhere in the middle of my sermon, who walks in? He did not sit in the pulpit. He didn't sit at the back of the church, but he came and he sat right on the front row. And while I was preaching, Elijah, he started making all these ugly faces in the midst of my sermon. He had the bulletin, he put it all over his head, he covered up his face. And I'm trying to preach, and I'm knowing that something is not going right because of all the gestures he's making directly in front of me. And when I got done, it was one of those Good Friday services, and when I got done, he walked up to the other fellas and said, man, you did good. Man, that was pretty good. And when he got to me, he looked at me, and all he said was, you did not study. And when I tried to muster up an answer, he walked away and left me standing there. Then all of a sudden, one of the other ministers, he's pastor now, Pastor Crystal Grundy, came to me and said, Pastor, won't you upstairs? And my question to him was he in his office or was he in the conference room? Because if he was in the conference room, he was going to show you how you could have done better. But if he was in his office, well, you about to get it. He says, not only is he in his office, but he's sitting behind his desk. Oh, Jesus. I was moving at a snail pace, and all of a sudden, I heard from the office, Henry, get up here. And made it up there, and he proceeded to tell me that was one of the worst sermons he'd ever heard in his life. And as he's telling me that, all of a sudden there's a knock on the door, and all the other preachers had come in, and we had about 18 at the time. And he was saying that was the worst sermon he had ever heard. And when he would calm down, one of the other fellas would get him riled up all over again. And I'm sitting there, and I'm so angry. I left out of the church, and my first wife, who was dating at the time, and I'm driving home, and she's touching. Oh, yeah, don't touch me, don't. I'm all right, just don't touch me. I'm trying to drive and keep my manhood, and that tear was right in the corner of my eye, and she touched me again, and I said, needless to say, I did not call him for 3 weeks. Every Sunday, I normally sat next to him. I was sitting at the other end of the pulpit. I didn't even want to be close to him. Only to discover he wouldn't call on me either. I figured I better call, and when I called, he when he answered the phone and heard my voice, he started all over again. Lord, it is my son who has returned from the dead, who had that awful dying day. Lord, it's him. He said, how have you been since your life? And it was at that point he proceeded to tell me his frustration. He says these words to me. He says, I spend time with you. I invest in you. I've shown you things that I haven't shown the other fellas. I've taught you stuff that I haven't taught the other fellas. So I expect more out of you because I invest in you. And when you know better, you are supposed to do better. Brothers and sisters, I submit to you this morning, that is the thought of the Apostle Paul. His thought has always been, when you know better, you do better. And that's why every one of Paul's writings, he always, in the beginning, deals with doctrine. And then he moves from doctrine to duty, because when you know better, you're supposed to do better. Yeah. I want to say to you this morning, chapters 1 through 8 deals with doctrine. Chapters 9 through 11 deals with dispensation. And the remaining chapters deal with duty, because when you know better, you do better. And I'm looking at some people here that has been your situation in life. There's more expected of you when you know better. And so this morning, I want to peruse the parameters of the text, and let's just see, what was Apostle Paul aiming when he says, I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God. I got one question. Are y'all going to walk with me? Number one, I want you to notice Paul's request. The Bible says, I beseech you, therefore, brethren. This word beseech, parakaleo. In the Greek, it's a compound word. Kaleo means to call, and para means near or alongside of. It suggests the idea to call near, but contextually speaking, it suggests here to make an appeal. It's in the present tense, which means repeated action in the present. Paul just didn't make this request one time. He kept on making the request. He says this, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God. Yeah. He says mercy suggests the ideal. He's an ultramas, the ideal. He says it means compassion or it means pity, but its genitive case suggests the idea that this adjective is describing another noun. Suggests the idea is God is a God of mercy. He says this request is standing on the fact that God is a God of mercy. And then it suggests this is plural. So it suggests that God has more than one kind of mercy. Do I have a witness in here? And maybe that's why Lamentations 3 says God has new mercies every morning. He has a brand new mercy every morning, because he's got a brand new mercy for my brand new misery. For whatever I am going through, it suggests that God has a mercy just for me. Do I have a witness in here? Am I talking to somebody in here this morning? You can testify that you've experienced God's mercy, that God has been merciful in your life. You know, mercy suggests that it's given me something that I don't deserve. So let me ask it like this. Has God ever given you something that you did not deserve? You know for a fact that you know for a fact deep down within yourself you did not deserve it, and yet God came through for you. Do I have a witness in here? When you wasn't supposed to get it, God gave it to you. When they told you you wasn't going to get it, God opened up a way for you. When they told you you couldn't have it, somehow God opened the He said, wait a minute, I am justified. He said, when God looks down at me, he doesn't see this faltering, failing, flawed person that I am, but he sees his blood covering me. He doesn't see me as I really am, but he sees the blood of his son over my life. Can I tell you that is God's mercy?
Yeah.
Romans also says we have access unto God. We have an introducer. Jesus Christ is my introducer. He's the one that has taken me by my hand and walked me in and said, Lord, this is another one of your children. He's my introducer. He's my access unto God. That's his mercy. Do I have a witness in him? Romans chapter 8 says, he says, and we know that all things are working together for the good. Watch this. That you present your bodies a living sacrifice. Watch this. He says sacrifice. He said that you present peristomy, which suggests the idea to stand or to put on exhibit, to offer yourself to be put on exhibit. He says, now that you know better, now that I spent all these chapters trying to teach you something better, he says, now that you are experiencing the mercies of God, he says, offer yourself to be on exhibit for him.
Right.
He says, stand for him. Oh, he says, wait a minute. He says, a living sacrifice. Now, what he's saying is God does not need another dead sacrifice. Do I have a witness in here? He does not need another dead sacrifice. What God wants is a living sacrifice. You know, people, I've died for the Lord. No, he don't want you dying for him. He wants you living for him. Everywhere you go, that you let your light shine, that you live for him. Where, Henry? On your job, in your home, in your community, in your neighborhood, around your friends. You know, because we know how to come in here and shine real good. We know how to say hallelujah on cue in here. We know how to wave our hands in here at the right time. We know how to say amen at the right time in here. But what really matters is how do I live for him when I go out of here? He said, what I need, Henry, I need a living sacrifice. I'm done with dead sacrifices. Dead sacrifices are no more. I need a living sacrifice. I have to ask him, I said, Lord, what do you mean you are done with dead sacrifices? He said, well, Henry, when Adam and Eve sinned in the garden, I killed one lamb per person. I said, okay. He says, well, when the children of Israel was leaving Egypt and a death angel came, it was one lamb per family. I said, I got that. He said, well, on the day of Yom Kippur, when the priest went behind the holies of holies, it was one lamb for the nation. I said, okay. I said, wait a minute. I said, so Lord, you mean with Adam and Eve, it was one lamb per person. When they left Egypt, it was one lamb per family. On the day of Yom Kippur, it was one lamb for the nation. He said, yeah, Kimberly, but when John saw Jesus, he said, behold, the Lamb of God that takes away the sins of the world. I don't need another dead sacrifice. Jesus took care of that. What I
sacrifice. He said, but Henry, I also need a sacrifice that's been set apart. He said, holy, hagios in the Greek, which literally means dedicated for divine purpose. One that has been set apart. One that is perfect for God. Old chairman of our church helps me with this portion of my sermon. He's dead and no longer be with the Lord. But he was a mechanic. And he had this truck. And the pastor turned, the truck was beat up. The paint was all messed up. Had all kind of dents and cracks in the windshield. I think it only had one hubcap. The bumper in the back was bent. All kind of rust all over the truck. And every time he talked about that truck, he said, this truck is perfect. Mm-hmm. I said, Brother Whitaker, what do you mean this truck is perfect? It's beat up. Wouldn't nobody want to be in it? He said, yeah, but it's perfect for what I need it for. My nature has caused me to be flawed. Mm-hmm. Wish I had somebody in here. My nature has caused me to be messed up. And I'm looking at some people here. You might have some dents in your life. You might have some cracks in your windshield. Maybe you've been out for a long time and you got some rust build up in your life. Maybe your bumper is bent just a little bit, but God is willing to take you as you are, as long as you are willing to live for Him. Do I have a witness in here? And maybe that's why the songwriter said, just ordinary people, that God uses ordinary people. He chooses people like you and me, people who are willing to do as He commands. God wants you as you are, just be willing to live for Him. Do I have a witness in here? I'm flawed, I'm messed up, I'm faltering, and I'm failing, but God can use me just as I am. Do I have a witness in here? He says, set apart of God's use. God has a particular use for you. Yeah. And here's the thing. God didn't save any of us for nothing. Yeah. Yeah. Well, have a witness in here. He didn't save you just for you to walk around and say you are a Christian. He didn't save you just for you to walk around and say, I'm saved. He wants you to take what He's given you and use it to be a blessing to somebody else. Yeah. Well, have a witness in here. Yeah. He says, set apart. But then watch this. He says, a sacrifice that is suitable to the Savior.
Yeah, yeah.
He says, watch this. Acceptable unto God. You are a task which suggests the ideal to be well pleasing or to give pleasure to one. Now, here's the thing. How can I be suitable for one who is beyond? My nature has caused me to be flawed. All right. I came in this world short.
Yeah.
I came in this world damaged goods. Mm-hmm. How can I be acceptable? How can I be pleasing to one who's beyond perfect? Well, Moses helps me with this portion of my sermon. Moses says in Exodus 19:5, he says, now therefore, if ye will obey my voice.
Oh, no. Yeah.
Indeed, and keep my covenant, then shall ye be a peculiar treasure. Wait a minute. Treasure, something that's valuable. He says, the way I do it is obeying God's voice, keeping His commandment, doing His will. Even though I'm flawed, even though I'm fractured, even though I'm messed up, God says, if you hear and keep my word, He says, and so much so that when He looks down at me, and look, see, because it's just the idea that there are going to be some people when we get to heaven who have melodious voices, who were talented, who were gifted, and God said, you didn't quite do it right. But then there's going to be some people who was off key. There was going to be somebody who split their verbs. There was going to be somebody who just didn't talk right. And yet God says, you did it just the way I wanted you to do it. You heard me and you obeyed my voice. God is not looking at me on the outside. He's looking at me on my inside. And he looks at my sincerity. And I promise you, when there are going to be some people, God says, yeah, you were gifted, but you didn't really use it the way I wanted you to use it. Do I have a witness in here? Have you ever seen a football game where a guy, he returns the kickoff, and he runs 98 yards, dodging all the defenders, making it into the end zone, and the crowd is going crazy. He does his victory dance inside the end zone, and the rest of the team comes and jump all over him, and everybody's shouting, and all of a sudden, you see some yellow flags. Illegal something. Yeah. I would tell you, I really don't watch football. Yeah. Illegal something, and all of a sudden, the touchdown is no good. God is going to look at some churches that have all the people. Had all the voices. Had all the numbers. And yet, God is going to say there was a flag. God won't speak on my inside. He's checking me on my inside to make sure that I'm doing it right. Do I have a witness in here? Wait a minute. He says this. He says, your spiritual service. Bible reads reasonable. Logikos is just the idea of rational, where we get our English word logical from. It suggests the idea to be genuine. He says, God, he says, for me to give, what God is looking for is true worship. Are you with me? And see, here's the thing. It suggests this. Worship without doctrine is just me getting high off my emotions. Amen. Do I have a witness? Yeah. He says, you know, you hear people, I come for the praise and never the word. I come and never the word. I see, when I'm wrapped up in all of that, all I'm doing is getting spiritually high of my emotions. God says, I need some what? Word inside of me. It's the word that's going to change my life. It's the word that's going to save me. It's the word that's going to shape me. It's the word that's going to mold me. I don't have true worship if I don't have. All that hollering and screaming, and I ain't into that. And see, here's the thing. Doctrine without some worship is barren intellectualism. Meaning this, God suggests that there has to be a balance in my life. Wait a minute, I'm not into that. But yet, they go to the football game, the basketball game, and all the announcer has to do is say, wave your hand, and they wave their hands. We don't do a wave, they do a wave. We don't cheer, and they cheer for some fellas taking a ball, running it up and down a court or a field, and yet the God who saved their soul, I wish I had a witness already, you can't holler for him, the one who is taking your sins. You can't shout for him, the one that paid it all. You can't lift your hands for him. God says, what I need is some true worship. And true worship has a balance of both doctrine and praise. It's my emotions and my mind. Leads me to getting God Well, that was my first point. The answer is found in my second point. Watch what it says. I want you to notice the requirements and the rewards for a living sacrifice. He says, here it is. He says, be ye not conformed to this world. Right?
Yeah.
He says, a spiritual service, a sacrifice that's suitable to the Savior, a sacrifice that is set apart, a sacrifice that is living, but it comes from reframing, from adapting to the way of the world.
Amen.
He says, be ye not conformed.
Yeah.
Suke baptizo would suggest the idea of conforming or fashioning yourself. Wait a minute. It's in the imperative move, which means it's a command, right? It's in the present tense, which means it's repeated action, but it's with a negation. Anytime you have a present imperative with a negation, it's to stop an action that's already in progress. So really what he's saying is, stop conforming to the ways of the world. Wait a minute. Conforming suggests the idea of shaping on the outside
in.
It suggests the idea that I am taking on the ways of the world. I'm starting with it. I'm a Christian.
All right.
I'm saved. I'm blood bought. But I'm looking like the world. I'm a Christian. I'm saved. I'm blood bought. But I'm talking like the world. I'm a Christian. I'm saved. I'm blood bought. But I'm walking like the world. He says, stop conforming. Stop trying to look just like the world. Well, have a witness in here. You know, I'm amazed that some of us, especially when you get on social media.
Come on now.
I'm amazed of us who say we love Jesus.
Amen.
The things that we post on social media. Our young women are posting themselves. Revealing all that God gave them for everybody to see.
Come on, baby.
And then when you read their list of books, their favorite book to read is the Bible. Something is wrong with that.
Yeah.
Well, have a witness here. I've seen some of them. I've seen some of them in church. I've been to their churches, and they go Facebook Live, and they turning it up. They out wherever they are, and they turning it up, and drinking hand, cuss words, you know, and yet they say they love Jesus.
Amen.
I'm not saying, now wait a minute, let me give you one more. And then I've seen one in my church. I mean, it was posting how many drinks she had already had. Wait a minute, and she wasn't a spring chicken. Posting how many drinks she had already had. And all I'm saying is, Paul says these words, all things might be lawful, but not expedient. Meaning, I may have a right to do it, but if it's not a good look, if it hurts somebody else, he said, I ought not do it.
Yeah.
All I'm saying is, it's not a good look.
Good.
Are you with me?
Yeah.
And it shows who has the influence. It is really supposed to be us who are influencing the world, and yet it's the world that is influencing us.
Amen.
Well, have a witness in here. We looking like a we. We talking like a we. We dressing like a we. We walking like a we. Acting like a man. Yet we are the ones that's supposed to be a light to a dark world. He said it's not a good look.
Yeah.
Well, if you can't says, you know better, you ought to do better. God has done too much for you and I for us to be walking around acting like the world. How can you save a world if the world can't tell there's some difference between you and me? What reason, what incentive does a person has to come to Christ if I'm doing everything they're doing?
Come on, preacher.
Oh, man.
Got a friend here in this city. I ain't calling his name because I'm sure some of y'all know him. All on Facebook. He a preacher. Cigar all in his mouth. And they try to use the argument because so many books talks about Spurgeon smoked cigars and drank wine. And that's their foundation that they're standing on. As if Spurgeon is the example for us to follow. And here's the thing, it's hurting to me because when you read all of the comments, it ain't a Christian identifying with. It's the world with all kind of adjectives and yeah, man, that's my blank blank. And yet, you are to be an example.
Amen.
Paul says, stop conforming, stop taking on ways of the world. Are you with me? He says, you got to frame from adapting to this world, but secondly, he says, you've got to reshape yourself from the inside out. He says, instead of conforming, he says, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind. This word metamorpho, which is where we get our word metamorphosis from. It's the picture of a caterpillar who has gone in the cocoon but comes out of the butterfly. He says, I need to allow a change to happen on my inside. If I allow it to happen on my inside, my outside can't help but be affected. Do I have a witness in here? Now watch this. He commands me, but here's the thing. He commands, it's in the passive voice, which suggests he's commanding me to do something that I really, Dr. Cheney, don't have the ability to do on my own. Wait a minute. Change from the inside out, and yet my insides are messed up. How can I do it? He says, by yielding to the Spirit. Yes. Allow the Spirit to work on your inside. Allow Him to change you from the inside out. He said, what I need you to do, Henry, instead of fighting the Holy Spirit, allow it to lead you and direct you, and it's going to change you.
Yeah.
From the inside out. Are you with me? Then finally, he says this, by reframing from this world, reshaping yourself from the inside out.
Yes, sir.
But then he says this, by renovating your mind.
Amen.
He says, by the renewing, anakinosis.
He says,
to become new and become different by implications to become superior strong. But now watch this. This word renewing has several different synonyms. Take a look at it. This word also means to renovate your mind. To restore your mind. To recondition your mind. To refurbish your mind, to rehabilitate
your mind,
to upgrade your mind, to overhaul your mind. It also means to bring something up to code. What do you mean, Paul? Your mind is not up to code. Anytime you allow the world to shape how you move and how you act, your mind is not up to code. I wish I had a grid in here. emotions, your train of thought. He says, Henry, I need you thinking differently. Henry, I need you acting differently. Henry, I need you walking differently. Why, Lord? Because there's somebody on the outside. The only Bible they're going to ever see is you. And if you don't get your mind right, he said, they may miss the opportunity to meet me. For you and I to get to heaven, God says somebody had an opportunity to meet me. But because your mind wasn't right, they missed that opportunity. Well, Lord, that's on mine. It ain't on them, it's on you, because I was using you to get to them. Your mind wasn't right. He says somebody's life is dependent on. You hear me what I'm saying? Somebody in your family's life is dependent on it. Somebody on your job, life is dependent on it. Somebody in your community, life is dependent on it. Somebody you are going to come in contact with, life is dependent on it. And it needs you and I to have our mind right.
Amen.
Do I have a witness in here? I'm done, but now watch this. He says this. He says that you be able to recognize that which pleases God. I don't have time to go through all of that because we'll be here all day, but I want to go back to where he says it's your reasonable service. He says what it is. He says, Henry, it's your reasonable service. He says it's your true worship.
Yeah.
He says it's the least that you can do.
Yeah.
In essence, he said, Henry, it's only the right thing to do. In fact, what he says is, it's really fair. You know, I couldn't help but think about my parents. I looked at this text. You know, growing up, my daddy, you know, he would drive many miles to get to work. Sometimes he would drive, sometimes 70, 80 miles one way, just in order to get to work. He would really work long hours. And I remember one time we had an earthquake, and my daddy, he went to work early that morning, and he didn't come home until the next day. You know, sometimes my daddy, he would come home with cracked ribs. I remember one time coming in from school, and my daddy, he had a cast all the way up his leg. And soon as he would mend, he would get right back out there and go to work just to make sure we had what we needed.
Yeah.
You know, my mama, my mother, you know, she wanted to be